Thank you very much indeed. Thank you for your kind words. Just a word about the book, since you mentioned it. Indeed, pro-EU, and furthermore, I would add federalist, and this will show in some of the things I'm going to say later on. But unfortunately, the space for dreaming has been replaced by the place for nightmares. And this is very much what is going to figure in my presentation this evening. First, a bit of deconstruction. I'm French, so you know you never get away from Derrida for very long. The title, you know, Europe's Political Cohesion After the Eurozone Crisis. Well, yes, it is true. The crisis, in etymological terms, is over. Crisis as in a sudden, violent spasm of in a disease or any other problem of an acute nature. Mario Draghi helped put an end to the crisis phase, which began in 2010. He first did the long-term operations in December 2011, and in 2012, the threat of the outright monetary transfers brought the crisis to a close. But of course, if the crisis is closed, the problem is definitely not solved. And that is an important point to bear in mind. Secondly, and here I would take my distance, vis-à-vis the title, it wasn't or isn't the Eurozone crisis. The zone as such has very little to do with the crisis. The crisis has everything to do with, at one level, the euro itself. And the euro, of course, we should never forget that although the euro is not the EU's single currency, the euro is an EU policy. And for example, on the board of the European Central Bank, you have a Brit. Britain is part of the euro project insofar that the euro is a European Union policy. And at another level, of course, what we have witnessed is national sovereign debt crises, which have been given a systemic nature because of the fact that the countries involved belonged to the euro. So at those two levels, yes, that was the crisis of the euro, crisis of the sovereign debts, rather than as the Eurozone itself. The Eurozone institutionally, procedurally, has comparatively little consistency. We can come back, and I'll also come back to that at a later stage. Just a bit of a reminder of what happened in order to have the perspective which will allow us to try to answer the question about Europe's political cohesion. The euro as a project is in practical terms 25 years old. The prehistory of the euro starts with Kohl and Mitterrand meeting over dinner, I think it was early December 1989 in Strasbourg, shortly after Chancellor Kohl's speech at the Bundestag on reunification. That's when the two heads of state in the framework of the French-German relationship decide that there will be monetary union and there will be political union as part of the same continuum as the one to which was going to belong the Union of Germany. Of course, the notion of monetary union was older than that, but this is what got the ball rolling. Even if some commentators, I'm thinking here of Arnaud Le Parmentier's excellent book, I don't want to deter you from reading it, which bears a title which blames the French for much of what happened afterwards. But unlike such commentators who would want us to believe that the decision to make the euro was taken in 1988. No, in political terms, what sealed the pact was the entente between Kohl and Mitterrand, linked very directly to the fall of the wall and the decision to have German unity go ahead. Once Mitterrand had realized, after his meeting with Gorbachev in Kiev, sounds strange to say it that way, in early December 1989, when Mitterrand realized that German unity was going to happen come hell or high water. The euro is launched, the Maastricht Treaty as a project. The Maastricht Treaty seals the compact. The criteria, well-known criteria, are defined: 3% of deficit, 60%, no more than 60% debt vis-à-vis GDP. But at that stage, early 90s, the markets don't believe in the euro. Not yet. They know that there's a project. They know that stuff is happening, but the markets don't integrate the project into their own expectations. And this changes in 1995, 1996. What happens in 1995, 1996? Well, Jacques Chirac, initially, after his election to the presidency in France, sort of tries to convince Kohl that it would be a good idea to do a referendum on the euro. In France, this was a notion that had been put forward during the electoral campaign. And of course, if such a referendum had taken place in France, the answer would probably have been no, given the narrow margin with which the Maastricht Treaty was adopted in referendum in France a couple of years before. But very quickly, Chirac realizes that Kohl is obviously not going to go along with this bizarre scheme. And furthermore, because Chirac was intent on relaunching nuclear testing, which was not going to help French-German relations, Chirac had enough on his plate in terms of relations with Kohl not to overload the system by pressing the referendum issue. So that's pushed out of the way. The selection for entry into the euro begins. Italy is given, as you know, a special dispensation. The Italian debt, compared to GDP, was comparable to what it is today. And I make that remark en passant, but not innocently, because I'll come back to that later on. And on the French side, the French actually squeeze into the criteria much more narrowly than we would want to be reminded of ourselves, because the only way we could get into the 60% criteria without asking for a special dispensation like Italy was by having a one-off a transfer of cash linked to the privatization of France Telecom, also known as Orange, more recently. And lo and behold, once the selection has been made, once the talk about the Club Med countries not being able to make it in, that was the Bundesbank's head, Tietmeyer, who went on about preventing Spain and Italy and Portugal from joining. Once that was put to the side, all of a sudden, the markets decide that the euro is going to be real. And you see the beginning of this extraordinary process, not only of reduction of interest rates were at that stage on the global scene in a process of sharp decline, but in the case of Europe, not only reduction, but also the massive convergence of all interest rates in the European Union, future euro countries, towards the German interest rate. The spread between between Italian and Spanish interest rates and German interest rates on the eve of the introduction of the euro, the spread was, I speak from memory, something like 7 or 8 basis points. That's 7 or 8 of a percent. That is, of course, a ridiculously low number. Why did the markets make that assumption? Because the euro was sold by all and sundry, notably in Germany, as being, and I use the German wording here, stark wie die Mark. Well, if it was stark wie die Mark, the markets were going to consider it as a proxy for the Mark. And that therefore Greece, and when it came in a few years later, but before that Spain, Italy, France, were all going to be treated pretty much like Germany. And this happened even before the euro replaced the national currencies in international financial transactions on the 1st of January 1999, and of course later on when the euro replaced hard currency bills and coins on the 1st of January 2002. Then, of course, we know what happened, although we sometimes forget it. We had a period of 6 years, 7 years of massive imbalances within the Eurozone, with German and French cash moving south, English cash, not in the Eurozone, British cash moving to Ireland, building up the housing bubbles and the other bubbles in the Mediterranean countries and in Ireland. As Gordon Brown put it subsequently in a piece he wrote in the New York Times, I think it was in summer of 2009, he wrote that in Spain and Greece there wasn't a single cocktail party at which German bankers were not pouring the champagne, which is another way of saying that irresponsibility, massive irresponsibility, characterized the action of creditors and debtors alike, which is, here again, not an innocent remark, because currently in Brussels, as in Berlin, we live in a world in which only debtors bear guilt. Creditors never bear guilt. Creditors are always serious, upright people who never pour champagne at parties. This ties in directly to political cohesion. This is not I'm not doing an excursion away from our subject. To the contrary. So here we were on the eve of the crisis. We're in the summer of 2007, just before Northern Rock tanks in the United Kingdom, non-euro country, I would add, but that's where the financial crisis began in Europe, with only subsequently 6 months later or so, the beginnings of the economic crisis along with the financial crisis. So here we were with Greece, Spain, Italy having enjoyed enormous growth, and in some cases, true modernization, in the case of Spain. Spain, incidentally, was the only large country in the European Union which fulfilled the Maastricht criteria on the eve of the crisis. This was the only country which had a debt of less than 60% of GDP, the only country which was doing less than the 3% deficit. Indeed, it had a budget surplus, which is another way of saying that you cannot put a single currency on autopilot and have it run on the basis of criteria. Criteria are useful, maybe even necessary, but they are not sufficient to do the pilotage of a crisis. So, eve of the crisis, what was the situation? First of all, we had no institutions dedicated to running the single crisis apart from the ECB with its narrow mandate. This is not to say that the people who invented the euro, who built it up in the 90s, were idiots and didn't realize what they were doing. They knew very well that the institutions were not there. They were simply assuming that as the currency would endure shocks, the institutions would be built up, particularly as during this time, political union was supposedly moving forward. And indeed, it moved forward more or less stutteringly until it came to a very sharp halt in mid-2005 with the negative votes of two of the six founding states in the referendum on the European Constitutional Treaty in France and the Netherlands. But until then, the assumption that institutions would catch up with the currency, that assumption was overbrave. It turned out to be wrong, but it was not in itself absurd. Secondly, and much more difficult to understand, creditors, public or private, but in those days mostly private, exercised essentially no due diligence on the requests of their debtors, provided that their prospective debtors were running debts in the dozens of billions, and not the sort of debt you run when you have to buy a home. When you buy a home and you go to your bank for a loan, the bank is going to ask you questions about how much you earn, whether you have a steady job. At least that's the way it works in my own country, and I assume that probably not different anywhere else. The bank actually exercises some sort of diligence vis-a-vis its prospective creditors. But when it came to the bubbles in Greece and Spain and Portugal, Ireland, no due diligence was exercised. The exposure of German and French banks in Greece ran cumulatively somewhere close to 150 billion euro, as if you could not learn on Wikipedia that Greece never had a land registry, that Greece never had a proper income tax system. These were not discoveries which were made after 2010. This was Greece, and it had been bequeathed to Europe from the Ottomans during the 19th century. But no. Creditors do not need to worry about such things. And pretty much the same thing happened in Spain, where Spain was building, Spanish real estate people were putting, were launching 1 million houses a year. That's twice as much as France did during the boom years of the 50s and the 60s, where we were rebuilding a housing stock which had been shattered by the Second World War. And all of this in a country which had two-thirds of the population of France. You know, something must have been wrong, but the bankers never noticed it. Nor did their regulatory authorities back in their own country. This is what happened. This was not Spanische Schlamperei. This was German and French and other banking incompetence. Thirdly, there was no optimal currency area, not before the creation of the euro, that stands to reason. But by the time we reached the eve of the crisis, the euro in itself had not contributed to a higher degree of integration in terms of the four freedoms: freedom of movement of people, of capital, services, and goods within the European Union, above and beyond what the single market was already doing. This is, incidentally, a very important point. It's not in itself very surprising, because single currencies historically do not tend to create optimal currency areas of their own spontaneously. Optimal currency areas are usually created by political decisions in peace and quite often in war. The Swiss franc was created after the War of the Sonderbund. and that was a political decision. And the dollar gained its preeminence in the United States after the Civil War, after 1865. I close the parentheses. We also had, on the eve of the financial crisis, this is also not an unimportant point, given the question which is posed about your political cohesion. At that time, we had highly interconnected financial markets in Europe. You know, I mentioned the exposure of German and French banks in Greece. Well, this is another way of saying that the banking community in the European Union was highly cross-border, highly mutually exposed. There's a beautiful graph by the Bank of International Settlements, which came out just at the beginning of the crisis, which showed the degree of interconnectivity between the banking communities of the member states of the euro. It was not called a banking union, because it wasn't a banking union in the usual sense of the term. You still cannot go, and you could not go at that stage, with a French check in euro to a Belgian bank and have it cashed without a cut being made into the Belgian bank. But otherwise, you had a high degree of integration. We had something which began to look like a European financial market, which is one of the reasons why the crisis, which I'm now getting to, took on the proportions which it took, because the transmission mechanisms, in case of a failure in one of the nation states, could readily pass systemically into the others. So a few words about the crisis, not to talk about the various episodes. You all have them in mind, what happened between 2010 and 2012, the 21 meetings of heads of state and government to try to save the euro, which was eventually done, but rather by Mario Draghi than by the governments themselves. But I'll simply get to the outcome, of the crisis. What do we have? Well, first of all, we've had a de facto broadening of the powers of the European Central Bank. This has been essentially to the good. In this, I disagree with many of my German friends who tend to consider that this is against all of the principles of ordoliberalismus. Thank goodness we had Mario Draghi. Secondly, we witnessed the combination of the economic, social, and social divergence between the states of the North and the states of the South, to put it in the most caricatural terms, along with the renationalization of the banking systems, and I tie the two things together. For a simple reason, is that is before the crisis, you had a high degree of integration, and you had a strong synergy between what was going on in the South and the North, of an initially positive nature. If you simply look short term at growth rates, evolution of GDP, evolution of unemployment, and so on. Renationalization, our banking establishments have now re-become essentially national. That has major bearing on what may happen politically, because it means that the transmission mechanisms of crisis, in case of this or that country moving away from the Union, UK, or from the euro, let's say Italy, that the consequences would not be of the same nature as they would have been 10 years ago. We have also put into place a number of backstops, ESFS, EF, sorry, I, this one I never get, the European Stabilization and Support Fund, and the EMS, the European, these backstops are useful in case of a limited shock. They are not capable of dealing with a major shock. They do not deal with the with the issue of countries which are too big to fail, too big to save. And I'll come back to those when we get to the strictly political side of things. We have begun to put into place something which is called banking union. This will be put into place progressively between now and the end of the 2020s. This is essentially about transferring banking supervision from national authorities to the ECB. That's good. And it is about, here again, providing a backstop to banking failures in the medium range. But if you're talking about massive banking failure of the sort which we were threatened with at the end of 2011, the banking union is not going to cover that. And of course, as I said, the banking systems have actually been largely renationalized. So the term banking union is in some ways a bit paradoxical. But this is good progress. The Franco-German relationship has suffered direly. Here, a bit of a flashback. Mitterrand and Kohl had immense personal regard, respect, and friendship, to the extent that political animals, to the fauve politique of that nature, can be friends. And when reunification began, we all know that Mitterrand was as unhappy about reunification as Margaret Thatcher was. And he tried everything that he could to delay it or even to prevent it. But when Mitterrand realized that he could not prevent it and that the costs of delaying it would be unbearably high, he decided to play the European card with Chancellor Kohl. And so initially, the French-German relationship did not suffer too badly from reunification. Then we have a sort of Chirac interlude during his first term, which I already mentioned about the referendum and so on. And to make matters worse, Kohl has to step down. Schröder becomes the chancellor. Schröder and Chirac do not, at that stage, get along together at all. And Schröder, of course, in generationally, as was the case also of Lionel Jospin, who was prime minister during the first Schröder years, these were the first post-war generation people. And they had not been acclimaté they had not fallen into the kettle, if I can use the Asterix, Obelix comparison. They had not fallen into the kettle of French-German relations. We have a crisis in 2000, at the moment of the Treaty of Nice, between France and Germany. Here we had a salutary shock. Chirac understands that he has to get along with Schröder even if he doesn't like the guy. And Schröder, all of a sudden, discovers that he has to learn about French-German relations. And when I say learn, I mean learn, because he had his French-German advisor, who was Brigitte Sauzet. She organized crash courses for him. And she brought in all sorts of people, including myself, to meet Chancellor Kohl and to discuss the relationship and so on. And for the following 5 years, until the end of Chirac's term, things get back to normal, sort of. There's no sense of crisis in the relationship, even if there isn't much progress. But with the crisis, there we really get into the big difficulties. Sarkozy and Merkel have to learn to get along with each other. They eventually acquire the ability to do so. But in the meantime, German political and public opinion becomes convinced that due to its own excellent performance in macroeconomic terms, and Germany's performance was comparatively excellent, and that is the fact of the matter, that it therefore did not need to take into account as systematically the French standpoint as had previously been the case. And then we get to Hollande. Hollande is elected in part because he came out against the new stability pact, which was decided upon in December 2011, which was signed a few weeks before the election in France in 2012, which was one of the reasons why Hollande denounced it, saying, you know, these things are not done. You don't sign these sorts of treaties a few weeks before you have a big election in one of the major member states. And Hollande, as soon as he is elected, decides to do the exact opposite of what he had stood for. He goes to Mrs. Merkel, asks for something in exchange for ratifying the treaty. She gives him about this much, which was the promise of a growth codicil, not encased in the treaty language, but alongside the treaty, the stability pact, somehow there was going to be a big stimulus. But everybody knew that this was a joke. And of course, yes, it was a very bad joke. And so Hollande came out of this looking domestically not only ineffective, but working against his own promises. This is not the only area in which he has done this. And in the eyes of the German political elite, including, I think, Mrs. Merkel, he came out as a weak person whom you could push around, which, unfortunately, I think, was not untrue. So a relationship which has become unbalanced, which has become not mutually respective, the element of mutual respect is no longer there. The notion of a Gaullist type of ardente obligation has disappeared. This is one of the consequences of the crisis years. And last, and definitely not least, in order to save the euro, we destroyed growth. We destroyed growth, not only in the short term, but also in the long term. And let me explain that for a moment. We destroyed growth not because we have nasty people in power, but simply because once you have a single currency, you no longer have national monetary instruments at your disposal. The only monetary instrument is in the hands of the European Central Bank, with policies which by definition are of a one-size-fits-all nature. And of course, whereas in the past, if you take the case of Italy, Italy is a country which has had very high growth from 1945 to 1980. Very good performance, largely built on a combination of export, high-performance export industry, along with competitive devaluation and building up of a debt. Was this good or bad? I don't know. But somehow, for a third of a century, it worked. Italy today, if you give Italy a 25% devaluation, Italy would probably rediscover growth. I hasten to add that Italy has had zero growth of its GDP, not simply since the beginning of the crisis, but since the introduction of the euro. 1999, 2014, in real terms, GDP has not moved upwards. This is very unusual in history, for an economy which is that large. So, if you cannot do external devaluations, you do internal devaluations. What are internal devaluations about? They are about reducing unit labor costs through the reduction of salaries, and you also do some reduction, of course, of public spending. That's fine if you are in an environment which is oriented towards growth. if the environment is recessionary, you're doing what is called a pro-cyclical policy, which is a polite word for saying you're making a bad situation worse. And this is indeed what has happened. This helps explain why we have not yet, in the aggregate of the Eurozone, therefore Germany included, Belgium included, and so on, we have still not recovered the GDP level at the end of 2007. This is the world's second largest economy, which is has been stalled now, literally stalled, for 2008, 2009, 2010, 2011, 2012, 2013, 2014, 7 full years. Because it isn't the fourth quarter of 2014 which is going to change that picture substantially, alas. So that's the short term. Short term sacrifice, we have to do internal devaluation and structural reform, and a lot of that I would agree with, by the way. But when you have to do it all through internal devaluation, and none through external devaluation, and you have to do it in a global economy which is fairly soft, and in a European environment which is even worse, you are going to come up with results which are not good in terms of growth. What is worse is that none of these policies, including in Germany, it's very important, none of these policies have done any good for investment, public or private. You have all heard about the debate in Germany about the lack of investment. I don't know how the debate will be resolved. Herr Schäuble, for the moment, is sticking to a ridiculously low number of investments for investment stimulus in Germany, national stimulus of, I think, 10 billion euro over the next 4 years. That works out at something like 0.02% of GDP. Very, very impressive. The problem is that this is a general situation, and it applies notably to the countries which have been engaged in the most convincingly in the policies of austerity. Now, if you don't invest today, you are depriving yourself of growth tomorrow. So we have lost nearly a full decade in terms of current growth. That's retrospective. But we have not put ourselves in a situation where we can recover growth substantially over the coming decade because of this lack of investment. So where does that leave political cohesion? I've taken some time to zero in on the topic, but of course you cannot zero in on the topic if you don't have this background, because all of this is about the livelihoods of people, of businesses, of countries. And it's more often than not pocketbook issues which determine the fate of elections in our countries. Hence the importance of doing this zeroing in process. So political cohesion, how have we been doing, how are we doing, and what's going to happen? Well, first, I begin with the good news. The good news is that there's been a very strong survival instinct of the European countries individually, with the exception of the United Kingdom, to save the euro, and of the EU collectively through its institutions, Parliament, Commission, Council, etc., to save the euro. This is true also of most of the countries which do not belong to the Eurozone. Sweden, for example, has chipped in money for the various support mechanisms which I mentioned earlier on. Sweden is not part of the Eurozone, but it considers that a disintegration of the Eurozone in a period of crisis would have had dramatically bad consequences. And of course, the Swedes were absolutely right. The ones who did not do it were the Brits. So a strong survival instinct, which gives me some hope in terms of what may happen in the future. The survival instinct, by the way, did lead to extremes. You know, I mentioned, I used the Vietnam War formula, destroying the village to save the people, destroying growth in order to save the euro. This also applied to those small member states which got into trouble, like Greece. You know the sentence in the Erlkönig, "Un bist du nicht willig, so brauch ich Gewalt." Well, here the threat was, "Un bist du nicht willig, so brauch ich Argentinien." You know, the option is between accepting our conditions and you stay in the euro and you stay in the union, or else you're cast into the outer wilderness and you will have absolutely no ability to strike a deal with the IMF or whoever. You're going to be the new Argentina. But however tough and harsh that may be, it did demonstrate a survival instinct. The problem is that this survival instinct did not lead either to more cohesion in terms of creating an optimal currency area, nor did it lead to cohesion domestically. Let me start very quickly with the optimal currency area. An optimal currency area is an area in which the existence of a single currency provides more benefits and causes fewer evils than would be the case if the countries belonging to that area decided to or continued to have separate currencies. And the instruments to measure whether an area is an optimal currency area tend to coincide actually quite nicely with the European Union's four freedoms: movement of people, movement of goods, services, capital. What has been the evolution? Well, in terms of movement of people, the studies which have been commissioned by the Commission, if I can abuse that repetition, tend to demonstrate, notwithstanding anecdotal evidence about Spaniards going to Germany or Greeks going to Austria, that the main flows of people within the European Union are actually between non-euro countries, the Poles in Britain in particular, 500,000 Poles in the United Kingdom, and ask David Cameron whether that has an influence on his own political, on his own policies, and possibly on his own political fate, and his answer will be obviously yes. This is important for Britain, this is important for Poland, but the stuff between Spain and Germany is actually not very important for Spain, nor is it for Germany. And to take another metric, we are still at around one-fifth of the levels of inter-country movement as compared to interstate movement within the United States or within Australia, to take two federal countries. And there has been very little change in those levels over the last 10 years. So we're not getting there. At least we're not going backwards. In terms of goods, things are still okay, but when I listen to some of the French politicians about protectionism, and not simply protectionism vis-à-vis outside the Union, but also within the Union, I get a little bit worried. But that pushes us to the other part, that is internal dislocation. Services, single market in services, we're not getting anywhere soon, so let's put that to the side. Then the free movement of capital. We went of capital, you know, which has been around now for about 30 years, early 80s. We've had the renationalization of the banking systems, which is, of course, a step backwards if you're talking about the creation of an optimal currency area. And secondly, we have the quite extraordinary, small but still extraordinary case of Cyprus. Cyprus is a member of the Eurozone, which uses the same currency as Belgium or France, but which is still under currency controls, capital controls. And although if you go on holiday in Cyprus and you bring back Cypriot euros, coins and bills, you will be able to pay with them in other euro countries without any problem. But if you try to do a bank transfer, if you're a British retiree and you want to move from Cyprus to France, build your second home in France rather than keep it in Cyprus, you're going to take about a 10% cut out of, because the value of the euro in Cyprus is no longer the value of the euro in the rest of the Eurozone. Very bizarre. Which is another way of saying that our survival instinct has also made us exceptionally creative. Which is another way of saying that when people like myself come up with suggestions, it is more difficult today to say, oh, this is much too creative. This cannot happen. Well, given the sort of stuff we've made happen over the last few years, inventing something as bizarre as the Cypriot situation today took a lot of talent and display, and shows that there's a fair margin of maneuver in terms of getting into innovative solutions. Now, domestic disintegration, dislocation, domestic lack of European cohesion. That is not necessarily domestic cohesion, but cohesion vis-a-vis others in the Union. We used to be worried about Greece and the rise of Golden Dawn and in a different way of Syriza and so on. And those ways may still be necessary. But what has become truly worrying is what is happening in the big countries. Too big to fail, too big to save. Individually and one vis-a-vis the other. So let me go down the list. Let me start first of all with the United Kingdom, not in the Eurozone. Traditionally the most Eurosceptic of the great powers in Europe, where the domestic political debate is now very much driven by the Europhobia, no longer the Euroscepticism of UKIP, with the risk of self-fulfilling prophecies occurring. When David Cameron not simply expresses displeasure vis-à-vis Polish immigration or the threat of immigration from Romania or Bulgaria or whatever, but where he actually says we have to no longer consider as sacrosanct the freedom of movement, then you know you have a big problem, because that will not be negotiable. This is not simply about welfare tourism. Belgium, for example, fights welfare tourism, which is undertaken in the name of freedom of movement. If somebody from France goes to Belgium, sets up house with no intention of working, but simply to benefit from higher welfare remittances than would be the case in France, they tend to get thrown out. About 200 a year is the figure that I hear. This is okay in terms of freedom of movement. The European justice system considers that this is one of the limits you can put to the principle. But this is not what David Cameron was saying. He was saying that the principle itself had to be put into question. He was taking an ideological viewpoint, not a pragmatic viewpoint. He was being very un-English in a way. All of this because of the threat from the right, from UKIP. Will Britain do a Brexit, to use the Twitter hashtag? Nobody can tell at this stage. The possibility, though, is real enough to make us scared, particularly since nobody has a clue in Britain, and a fortiori outside of Britain, as to whether Britain will be governable after the elections next May. When people start talking about the possibility of a Labour-SNP coalition, you know that this is going to look more like Italy than like Norway in terms of political management. So already a very big question mark. And of course, a Britain which moves outside of the European Union means a very different European Union. The single market will not be defended in the same way without the British. Doing foreign security and defense policy without the British is going to become sort of tricky, because the dominant power will be Germany, which has a strategic culture which is rather different from that of France or Britain. Today, the French are somewhere in the middle and can hold together the Brits on the one end and the Germans on the other. If the Brits leave, that balancing game between the three powers will no longer be possible. That's Britain. Italy. Italy, Renzi got gloriously propelled into power after a political blitzkrieg of epic proportions. It was really amazing, you know, going from nowhere to somewhere. It was quite a case. Is he succeeding in pumping hope, energy, and growth back into the system? Well, hope there was, but it's a dwindling asset. Energy, there still is. But if it doesn't find practical outcomes, it's also going to be difficult to sustain. And as for growth, nobody can find it. Italy continues to be in an unalleviated recession. This means that Renzi's time will eventually run out. If growth doesn't come back within the next 2 years, he's dead. And then who takes over Italy? God only knows, and maybe even God doesn't know. Public opinion in Italy, according to the latest opinion polls, is divided about 45-45 in terms of staying in the euro. This is the major country in which of the Eurozone in which you have a truly split opinion on the merits of staying in the euro. This is new. Because I talked about the survival instinct earlier on. When people were threatened with a fate worse than Argentina's, this made them concentrate their mind and accept Spain and Greece and Portugal, enormous sacrifice in order to save the euro, because saving the euro meant saving their place in Europe. And they obviously want to keep their place in Europe. In the case of Italy, this is not working. Not anymore, in any case. And in any case, the Italians know that they're too big to fail and too big to save. And they will play on that. Italy, incidentally, has a strongly renationalized banking system, but also an essentially nationalized sovereign debt. About 70% of the sovereign debt is Italian held. It's not quite as high as in Japan, where it's about 90%. But still, 70% is a very high number, which means that if, for one reason or another, Italy were to leave the euro, Italy is the one country which could monetize most of its debt, which is a euphemism for saying that devaluation and inflation would cut back the debt burden in Italy to the detriment of the middle classes. But it would work. It would actually be a way of doing away with the debt. Italy is, in that sense, in a situation quite different from that of France, to a lesser extent, of Spain. France, we don't really have an economic crisis. And this may sound a bit surprising, given all of the articles you read about how dreadfully badly we're doing. You know, we have the impression that we live in European version of Somaliland sometimes, when you see the amount of economic French bashing which is going on. Well, France, despite all of its unreformed economic and social laws, despite the weight of the state, despite this and despite that, we, in terms of growth, in terms of unemployment, we continue to be, as we have been over the last 15 years, at the exact median of the Eurozone. Neither too hot nor too cold. Is this a great situation to be in? No, because growth is zero. Is this a terrible situation to be in? No, because Italy and Greece are a lot worse. And Spain has a backlog of non-growth, which is also truly awesome. Is this as good as Germany? No, of course it isn't. But it's not what you would normally call a big economic crisis. What we have is a political and moral crisis. Politicians are seen as not having done what they were elected for. Hollande is seen as not having fulfilled his promises. I will readily accept that most of them probably couldn't be fulfilled, but still he made them. And as for Sarkozy, those promises which he made and which he could have fulfilled because he had a mandate to do so, for example, on the 35-hour work week, he did not fulfill either. And as for Chirac, he made very few promises and did pitifully little in consequence. So when you have a perfect track record of non-performance on the political level over a period of 20 years, the last time we had a primary budget surplus, the last time we had 3% growth, etc., was under Jospin in the late 90s. So it's a bit more than 15 years. But since then, it's been a story of promises made and not fulfilled. And the French are sorely tempted to try what has not been tried before, that is the catastrophic policies advocated by Madame Le Pen. And because our institutions are exceptionally robust, this crisis can go on until the very last day of President Hollande's official term. So when you think about the atmosphere in France today and you spin it out for another 2.5 years, you have something which looks pretty awful. And pretty much anything can happen. Then we have Spain. Spain is doing a lot better. Yes, Spain has managed to reduce unit labor costs through very courageous domestic reforms. The poster child of big time reform in the Eurozone. It is beginning to enjoy a little bit of growth, but a few problems. First of all, there's a well-known phenomenon in political history, and that is revolutions do not tend to happen when things are going awfully bad. Revolutions tend to happen when people begin to have rising expectations. This is the Tocqueville line about the French Revolution. The French Revolution did not happen because things were going atrociously. It happened because they were expecting better things to happen, and they weren't happening. And in the case of Spain, there is a strong flavor of that with the rise of Podemos. And two other factors specifically related to Spain. One is the demoralization, and here we are in a moral crisis, in effect even worse than in France, which is the crisis due to the uncovering of successive layers of corruption at all levels of government, including within the heart of the monarchy. Now, when it gets there, when the king has to abdicate, you know that you have a really big problem on your hands. And whether this will materialize when the next general elections take place in the form of Podemos, making it impossible to have a single color coalition at the top, I don't know. We'll see. And the other problem, of course, is Catalonia, which is being deprived of the Scottish option. And being deprived of the Scottish option, things are not likely to develop in a nice, friendly, gentle, stable manner. Now, I'm not saying that any one of these countries or all of these countries are going to blow up. I'm simply making the point that when you have four countries, which are essentially four detonators lying around ready to blow up if circumstances are right, one of them is liable to blow up. I don't know which one it's going to be, one or several. Over the next 5 years, one cannot expect steady state to remain the opposite description for what is going on in Italy, Britain, France, or Spain. And then we have Germany. A word about Germany. Germany has done a fantastic piece of work with the Schröder reforms, Hartz IV, Hartz I, II, III, IV. We always forget I, II, III. Reforms with internal devaluation at a time of non-crisis, when there was an external environment which was buoyant, very buoyant. The global economy was doing very, very well at the time when Schröder was doing his very courageous stuff. A grand coalition where the SPD managed to maintain the impetus of some of these reforms after the 2005 elections. A Germany which multiple institutions of a federal nature I think has pretty much run out of its political steam to the extent that it ever had any. The other problem, of course, is that this would, if economically successful, and it could happen, if we're economically successful, lead to the creation of a gigantic current account surplus. You know, when I say Germany 7% of GDP, that sort of sounds like an abstract number. That is more than China's current account surplus. We used to believe that we had a problem with China's current account surplus. Well, compared to Germany's, China's current account surplus has been going down, at least as a share of GDP. So if we have that scenario, or more accurately, it's a combination of scenarios. One is we simply continue with the current federal, the non-federal integration process, or we do more federal integration. The latter may be economically more successful than the former, but it would be politically even less acceptable than the current muddling down. Third scenario, the federal jump. We create politically accountable institutions, a European Department of Treasury, a European government, not European governance, which is a weasel word, or we don't create an economic government. I don't know what an economic government is. In democracies, parliaments were usually set up to deal with the budget. Democracy is very economic in its essence. So when we talk economic government, in order not to say European government, we are using weasel words, and public opinion actually senses this and reacts to this negatively. Now here, a European government. I'd like that to happen. That's my preferred one. This is not on political offer today. It wasn't on offer by any party in any EU country during the last EU parliamentary elections. Why is this? Because people are not ready to move more power to Brussels, even to democratically legitimate institutions, because of what public opinion sees as the pretty atrocious performance of Europe compared to the rest of the world over the last 7 years. And unfortunately, public opinion has a point. So this is the federal jump is not going to happen until we've had a return to growth through other means. Then the fourth scenario, federalism in the Eurozone only. Because when I talked about federal jump, I was talking about the EU. The EU exists. It has institutions. It has a genetic code. It is about creating an ever closer union, which is what the treaties say. So therefore, the federal option is actually hidden somewhere in the DNA of the European Union, which is one of the reasons why the folks at UKIP really don't like it. But you also have the Eiffel Group, the Glienicke Group in Germany, is advocating what I would call federalism in the Eurozone only. Those who don't want to be in the Euro or cannot be in the Euro are cast into the outer darkness. We have Brexit by definition. And the European project is in effect recreated in political terms in the framework of the countries which have the euro. This is in a way an attempt to redo what was done in 1948 with the creation of the Deutschmark. Deutschmark was created in order to make it possible to create the Federal Republic of Germany. This, incidentally, is a historically unique case of the currency preceding the union. It hasn't happened anywhere, and of course it happened in a place which was under occupation, which was politically shattered. And of course, nobody had any doubt about the fact that Germany was always there, that there was a polity called Germany, even when there wasn't a government called Germany. In the case of the Eurozone, I don't know very many people who would answer if you did. The fact that there isn't, hasn't been an opinion poll, to my knowledge, on this question actually in itself is revealing. You have these opinion polls where people are asked, what do you consider to be your primary identity, your secondary identity, your tertiary identity? Is it the European Union? Is it your country? Is it your region? And you have different results in different countries. And you actually have a substantial number of people who answer it's the European Union. It's overall, the notion that there may in time develop a European patriotism is not out of the question, which is why I remain a federalist. But I've never seen the question answered, are you a citizen of the Eurozone? You know, what is it? What is written on your passport? It's not about the Eurozone. Creating a country simply because you have a problem running your currency, an entity in which you don't have a clear prima facie sense of belonging, that is going to be sort of difficult. And speaking from the strategic aspect, once again, back to the problem of Britain, a Europe to which Britain does not belong is a Europe which is going to have a big problem, because you will have one country in the middle, which is called Germany, which has its own strategic culture, which is, as to use the old Kissinger formula, too big to be comfortable for its neighbors, not big enough to exercise hegemony. It would be back not to the old days, because I think we have all been cured and vaccinated from the adventures, the bloody adventures of the 20th century. But we would be back to a situation of competition, of ganging up, which today does not exist, because the European Union's competences are fairly widely spread around. There is no German hegemony at the EU level. And the last scenario, which is the one I prefer, it's also the least likely in political terms, that's trying to engage in what is the most difficult strategic exercise, and that is a strategic retreat, a strategic fallback from the euro as a single currency to the euro as the functional equivalent of what used to be the European currency unit between 1979 and 1999, that is a unit of account in monnaie de compte, a common currency but not a single currency, where nations would return to their national currencies with the functional equivalent of the old European monetary system and or to the European exchange rate mechanism, a system which would be quite disorderly, because it was quite disorderly when it functioned, but which did not prevent the single market from happening, which did not prevent the European Union from happening, which indeed made the European Union possible to manage. If this were technically and politically doable, I would argue that this would help restore growth in countries which could use a devaluation. It would force, and this is herein lies a paradox. The Germans rightly say that most of the other member states of the EU need structural reform. Countries like the UK or like Sweden, which have done substantial structural reform, are in a minority. We have to do it. But what are the markets telling us? The markets are telling us, you have the euro. telling us, France, you have the euro. You have always paid your debts. You manage your debt, your debt beautifully. The French debt management system, in technical terms, is a marvel. The French Treasury does this with great experience and art. We always pay our stuff on time. We are completely reliable. Our taxation system, which of course the media say is punitive, and it is punitive, and does all sorts of unhappy things to all sorts of people, including myself. The fact is the tax system works. That is, it soaks up the money in a big way. And therefore, our creditors know that we will continue to have the means to pay. And if that isn't enough, we have Germany next door, which will not do anything which would weaken France's position. So we have that situation. What do the markets say? They say, you're doing fine, guys. We will give you an interest rate which is 50 basis points above that of Germany only, like that of Britain. You know, ridiculously low. We've never had interest rates as low in all of our history. And it continues to go down week by week by week, ever since the mid-90s. The curve is like this. So when you're a politician and you have the markets telling you, you don't really need to do structural reform, are you going to do a Schröder? Well, if you're Manfred Schröder, you are. But most politicians are not Manfred Schröder. Most of them are not suicidal. Most of them actually want to win elections, like Angela Merkel. Or suicidal, at least not knowingly suicidal, because some manage to be suicidal without really trying. Whereas if you have a national currency, interest rates will be on the basis of your national performance. And then you start feeling the pressure. And then you have to start reforming. So it's a paradox. Because as long as competitive devaluation was easy and painless, we could escape from that kind of pressure from the interest rates. We had high interest rates, but we made up for the high interest rates by constant devaluation. You need something which looks pretty much like what the European exchange rate mechanism looked like in the early 90s. Fairly narrow bands of fluctuation, fairly heavy firepower by what did not yet exist at the time, but the European Central Bank actually does exist, then I think you can have some of the good features of the old system without losing some of the things that we currently need, and that is actually pressure to do structural reform. But the only serious pressure for structural reform is going to be economic. It's not going to be from Angela Merkel or from some guy in the commission whose name will be forgotten 5 years down the road. That's the way politics work. Politics work because politicians can explain that pain is necessary because the alternative to pain is something worse. If the politician has to say in his speech, at the same time, the markets tell us that we have the lowest interest rates in our history, very difficult to sell structural reform, and even more difficult for a politician to want to do structural reform. So that's my idea for a strategic retreat. Go back to the conditions of the early 90s, bring back growth, and then hopefully move forward politically again, hoping that in the interval we haven't lost the Brits. I think it's terribly important to keep the Brits on board. If the Brits are willing to do even half of the gesture necessary to do so, hoping also that nothing has exploded in the interval. Technically, it's not as difficult as some people tell me it could be, but it still would be a high-risk venture. And as I say, politically, this is for the moment very unlikely. I said there was no political offer for federalism. There is no political offer for a strategic retreat. Those people who are against the euro today, politically, I'm talking about the political offer, are against the European Union, National Front, and so on. These are people who are not only not fréquentable, but their motives are deeply anti-European. My motives are the exact opposite, but they are not reflected in the political offer, malheureusement. Thank you very much. I think we have a bit of time to discuss.